One of the I got it's stage fright. I've lost all my perspicacity. What does that mean? Nobody knows. That's all right. All right, you guys do this wrong a lot. It's one of those things. There are two common mistakes you guys make with Half-Lives. Right? The first one's pretty easy. The second one's not. The second one's kind of unique. And I have an animation that may or may not work because it's on the internet and this is computers, you know, pretty old. But I have two ways I'm going to try to get it to work. But either way, let me show you the first one. If I tell you the half-life is something, never hit this too. Whoa, we're just off to a rocky start here. If I tell you a half-life, for example, is, I'm going to use 2 hours, I think, later, so let's use it now. So let's say it's 2 hours, right? I'm using seconds here anyway, so I'll say 2 seconds. So you might think to yourself that, well, say I'm given 80 grams of something. All right, 80 grams. All right, so if I have 80 grams of something, after 2 seconds, I'll have 40 grams of it, right? And then after 2 more seconds, it'll be all gone, okay? That seems to make sense. Half-life, half of it's gone in 2 seconds, the other half's going to be gone in 2 more seconds. But that's not correct, all right? As you'll see, if you watch this, after 2 seconds, half of it is going to be gone. But after 2 more seconds, the next half will be gone. And after 2 more seconds, the next half will be gone. And it keeps going like that. So you're going to get a graph that looks kind of like that. We can watch this happen. I have a little animation here. This isn't the one I'm talking about. But, you know, after 2 seconds, you got half of it gone. 2 more seconds, the other half. 2 more seconds, the other half. And so on. And what happens is, you've seen this in math class, this stuff approaches zero, but it never really reaches zero. Now, actually, in reality, hours will reach zero. You will get eventually a time in the future where somebody, or a radioactive substance, will not be radioactive anymore. All right? Period. You say, well, how come? Why does that violate the law of math? Well, it doesn't. Think about it. I mean, I know there are a lot of atoms, like 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd in a mole. But eventually, if I keep cutting that number in half, I'm going to eventually get down to a single number. I can't have a fraction of an atom, okay? A fraction of an atom is not going to decay, right? But in math class, you can take that, when you get down to 1, right, you can keep dividing that. You can divide that 1 by half and get 0.5, and then 0.5 and get 0.3. So that's why you never reach 0. Once that last atom decays, you're done, okay? So you actually can get to 0 when it gets to, when we're talking about half-lives here, because eventually all the atoms will have decay. Now, that's the first mistake you see, and I want to show you a little animation if this works, and it may not. I have two ways I'm going to try to do this, because the internet, this particular website also times you out. It's just a sample thing, but we'll try it and see what happens here. Yeah, subscribe now. I don't want to subscribe now. Behind that, probably not. Now, it's not going to let me do it that way, so I thought I'd try Firefox. We'll try it this way. I have it set up. Where is it? There it is. Let's see if this one works. Nope, your time's up. So apparently, basically, I tried this morning and it worked, but then it wants you to basically log in. It just shows you a decay here. The point I wanted to get you to understand about this is actually made by another graphic. I had a feeling this wouldn't work. I have another graphic that will show this right here. The crazy part, this is what it would have shown, like all these things decaying. The second mistake people make is they think that, well, if I'm holding in my hand a sample of radioactive carbon-14. When it's done being radioactive hundreds of thousands of years from now, I don't have anything in my hand. It's gone. That's not true. All it's done is those atoms that were radioactive have decayed to something else, but I'm still holding something in my hand. There are still atoms there. It's just decay. It hasn't disappeared,
We use the word disintegrate, and that's a bad word probably, because it makes you think that after this stuff goes away, as far as radioactivity, it goes away, the actual stuff goes away. Well, it doesn't. Your size of your sample is pretty much the same. Now, it's not exactly the same atoms there anymore, because carbon-14, for example, using him, we're going to use him in one of the examples, is in your body right now. It's a small amount of it. It's very, very small, like point something percent. Very, very small. But that, as that decays, you're basically not getting rid of all the carbon. It's decaying to something else. Maybe perhaps a stable form of carbon. Or in the case of uranium, it may eventually be decaying to lead. But you still have something there. It didn't disappear. Okay, so that's the second mistake people make on these kind of things. All right, but either way, I'm going to show you how to do calculations with this. All right, and these calculations can get, although they're not going to for us, they can get pretty hairy. Matter of fact, you can use calculus to do them. Is anybody in calculus in here? Nobody? Yeah, I didn't think so. This is Chem 1, so. I'm not going to show you how to do it with calculus, but you will. When you get to Wittner's or Gunther's or whoever teaches calculus now's class, they're going to teach you how to do these kind of first-order decay rates. And they'll use half-lives for an example. All right, but I am going to show you how to do it with simple math. We'll have to use a natural log. We'll have to use logarithms, but that's about it. You guys have heard of logs, right? You've used logarithms, so I'll show you how to do that. Anyway, let's get some notes on this, okay? Half-life, what is it? It basically is, as you'd expect, the amount of time it takes for half of a radioactive sample to decay. Now, we've been talking a little bit about half-lives, just basically the length of them for different elements. When I was doing the transmutation of uranium, and how, you know, that whole big long graph of it, it goes through all these different equations to get down to being something stable. Some of those half-lives were like in the millions of years. Some of them were seconds. Some of them were hours. Some of them were days. Some of them were years, just a few years. All right, so half-life can be, for some atoms, very, very long or very, very short. And you might think to yourself, the guys, a lot of times they'll, you know, try to scare you. You know, one of the biggest things I think is part of my job in both classes is stopping you from being so afraid of everything. And, you know, people will scare you. Scare tactics when it comes to nuclear waste, nuclear power, is how long this stuff will stay radioactive. And they use, of course, millions or hundreds of millions of years this stuff will still be radioactive. And that is correct. All right, they're not lying. There's another example of how you could take, you know, a little bit of information is not really, is a dangerous thing. That's an old saying, I think, Francis Bacon. A little information is a dangerous thing. And basically, it's true. The stuff up at the power plant, the radioactive waste from there, will be radioactive for hundreds of millions of years. But I'm not really worried about the isotopes that have half-lives of millions and millions and millions of years, because they're not giving off that much radiation. The ones that are the most dangerous aren't the ones that have really short half-lives of seconds or minutes or hours, because they're gone by the time they get the stuff out of the spent fuel pool. What you're worried about are the guys in between, the guys who are giving off a good deal of radiation but are going to stay radioactive for hundreds or even thousands of years, not millions of years. Uranium has half-life of millions of years. And I can, like I said, I've told this before, I can carry it around in my pocket all my life. I'd probably never have a problem, because the amount of radiation from a rock that contains some uranium in it is extremely small at any given time. It's not giving off that much radiation. All right. So that's the definition of a half-life, how long it takes for half of an original sample to decay. And, of course, I have to give you an equation to do these calculations. The equation, if I were to give you it from the book, or from a book that did calculus, would look totally different than this, okay? I made up this equation, pretty much. Okay, this is not in any book. This is a way to do half-lives without using calculus, okay? Oh, by the way, this results in exponential decay. And in fact, I find this equation that I have much more intuitive, much more, you know, understandable by you than an equation that just has a rate constant and uses, you know, E basically in it. It's very non-intuitive to do that, especially if you haven't had calculus. All right, here's the equation. Looks like this. And if you think about it, it makes sense. 1/2 to the x power is going to equal the amount left over the original amount, the fraction that's left. I want to show you how to use that equation in an example, but I want to show you all, and I've done this before, where we could do the problem in our head first and see what the answer is supposed to be, and then use the equation and see why it works, okay? So the first problem I'm going to give you is going to be pretty easy, okay? Here it is. By the way, that's this a over a sub 0 is basically the fraction or the fraction remaining, the percentage, not percentage, but the actual fraction remaining. If I give you a percentage, you have to turn it into a decimal, as you'll see in one of the problems. So let me show you what I mean. If I gave you this problem, could you do it using a little common sense first, and then we'll do it using our equation? Okay. Oh, I guess I didn't tell you x is the number of half-lives. Although this is kind of written in a thing, I guess you could write it all down. Those are the, it's a legend for what are those things mean, although it's written up there anyway. All right, copy that question now. Now, I made nice, easy numbers. And I'll give you a hint, something that, how I like to think about things. And maybe it'll help you when you're taking a test, a math test, a science test, physics, chemistry, where you get a problem that you don't really know how to do. And it happens. Especially in the short answer free response questions on an AP exam. There'll be some part of that question, maybe even the whole question, you won't know how to do. For either because it was never taught to you or because it was taught to you in September and you forgot it. So you can sometimes figure it out if you just use a little common sense. Like this would be an example of that. I may not remember how to do this by the calculus method with the equation that I could have written up here. I may not remember to do it even by the way I'm teaching you right now. But what could I basically do to get this answer? Can you figure it out? We could use a common sense approach to how I would get this answer. What would be a common sense approach? There are 2 days. It's a half-life, and I've waited 8 days. What am I going to do? How many half-lives did the guy undergo? How many? 4? Anybody agree? Underwent 4, right? Oops. Don't write this down. Don't write this down. He underwent 4 half-lives. So what could I do? I started out with 80 grams, right? I could basically divide 80 by 4? That won't work. What do I have to do? I have to divide 80 by 2 how many times? 4 times. So 80 divided by 2 is 40. Divided by 2 is 20. Divided by 2 is 10. How many times is that? 1, 2, 3. Divided by 2 is 5. That's my answer is going to be. I don't need this equation. I don't need the calculus equation with a rate constant in it and using E. I can just do it like that. Now, don't. I want to show you how you... Because what would make this harder? Obviously, I'm going to give you the fraction remaining won't just be, or the numbers won't just be a 2 and an 8 or 80. Nice, easy numbers to divide. But I made the first one like this so you can see what their answer should be. Now, I told you, this is how I figured it out. I came up with this equation by just figuring, okay, I know the answer has to be 5. How can I solve this? You know, and then I came up with this kind of an equation. It's, by the way, working it multiple ways, as you'll see when we do the other ones. So let's try doing it now by the actual method, all right? What would I have to write down? Well, the number of half-lives first, you write this down, is going to be x. That's what x is. So we divide 8 by 2, and we get 4. That makes sense. 4 half-lives. So I now know him from the equation. Now, if you're wondering, why am I doing this? Because you just showed me what the answer is. Again, you're not thinking. I'm not going to give you this easier problem on the test. I'm not going to give you something that you can just do in your head. Okay,
that 4 is x.
I got to figure out what this each one of these parts is and be able to do it with using ugly numbers. Okay, I know what x is. I know this. I don't have to worry about that. How about, do I know a or a sub 0, the amount left or the original amount? Sure, which one of those do I know? What does it tell me in the problem? What is the 80 grams? That's the original amount. All right, what am I asked for? I want to know how much will still be round. I'm looking for A, correct? So, right, you got it? So basically, I know everything I need to know now. I know X, I know A sub 0, half is a half. I'm just looking for that guy. And so I can plug this in, and I can get this done. 1/2 to the X power equals A over A sub 0. There's my equation. Write that down. So if I substitute it in, it's 1/2 to the 4 power equals A over 80 grams. Now, there's a couple of things you're going to probably have to be able to do on your calculator. Can you take 1/2 to the 4th power? Well, there's a couple of ways you can do that. Let's try doing it with just as 0.5 to the 4th power. Make sure you know how to do it on your calculator. You have to use different calculators do it differently. Okay? Can you tell me what that's going to give you? What's 1/2 to the 4th power? What's 0.5 to the 4th power? You could just go 2 to the 4th power, and it'd be 1 over that number. I realize that. But what would it be as far as the decimal's concerned? What'd you get, Kyla?
0.0625.
Correct. .0625 equals A over 80. So, if that's my equation now, what do I have to do? Well, I'm just going to cross multiply, right? So A is going to equal 0.0625 times 80 grams. And if you do that, do it. What do you get? Not a big surprise here. Did you get 5? Right? And that's why it works. That's how it works, I should say. It's not why it works. It's how it works. All right, good enough. Now, I can ask different questions. I don't have to ask each time how much will be left. I can sometimes ask you, how long will it take? Okay, so let's try asking that question next. And this one, we'll have to solve it a little bit differently, but using the same equation. Okay, copy that guy down. This is actually a more useful thing for radiocarbon dating. Carbon-14 dating. That's when carbon-14 goes out to the bars at night, tries to pick up some carbon-14, carbon-13. Well, for 13, you might get in trouble. It's not really old enough. Maybe carbon-16, 18. Got to be careful of that. There's no carbon-16 or 18. Just kidding. All right. Well, what do I know this time? Okay? Think about your equation and what you know this time. And what you're looking for this time. All right? We know the half-life is 5,730 years. I know that. But that doesn't really come into this early on. If the equation looks like this, what parts of those things do I know? What parts am I looking for? Well, it seems like I'm not given as much information as I need, but I am. Because I'm actually given two things in one. This A over A sub 0 is really, if you remember, I defined it two ways. I defined it as the amount you have left over the original amount or the fraction remaining. So both of these guys are contained in that fraction remaining. You see? 0.636. So 1/2 to the x power equals 0.636. That's really what you have there. Can I solve for x now? Well, I can, but it does require using logarithms. Matter of fact, you can do it by using a regular log, but we're going to use natural log because that's more common. Okay? So all I have to do is take the natural log, ln, on your calculators, of both sides. And by the way, again, the reason this works, okay, is because a logarithm or a natural log is the power to which something is raised, whether it's to the 10th power if it's a log or E for natural log. It's the power that you're talking about. So if I take a log of both sides, that brings this guy out of the exponent. Right? So if I take the natural log of 1 half to the x equals a natural log of 0.6, I take the natural log of both sides, that gets my x out of the exponent. X is no longer an exponent. So can you tell me what's the natural log of 0.5? What's the natural log of ln of 0.5? Everybody should do it on a calculator. Make sure you can find the right buttons and you can do this correctly. The ln of 0.5 is what? Did y'all get, I think it's like negative 0.693? Did you get that? Okay. And what's the natural log of 0.636? You should get negative 0.453. Make sure you do. Yeah.
Where did you get the 0.636
from? Right here. 63.6% in fraction form would be just two decimal places to the left, right? 0.636. And I should have said that. I did not. 63.6%, remember, is the percentage. The fraction remaining would be 0.636. All right. Does everybody get those numbers? Well, that's easy now. Just divide. X is going to equal that divided by that, or 0.654. Now, you are not done, but you're pretty close. What does X mean? X is how many half-lives this guy underwent, right? It didn't even undergo one half-life, and that makes sense, okay? If I still have more than half of the wood left that's radioactive, the carbon in the wood that's radioactive, then I can't have gone through five. If this said 50%, how old is the wood? 5,730 years. For those of you who don't realize this, that's how you date. That's how you can tell how old certain things are. All right? It's based on the assumption that while the tree was alive, it kept incorporating carbon from the atmosphere into its organism. Right? When it dies, it's no longer doing that. And it's rotting. So all the only carbon it has there, it's not getting new carbon anytime. The carbon it has there is basically just decaying. So all the carbon that's in there is going, or that's radioactive, is going away. So if I wait 5,730 years for a tree cut down today, he will have half the radioactivity of a tree that's growing today. Okay? That makes sense? So that's how you can tell how old things are. It's not really totally, completely 100% accurate for a lot of reasons. One of the reasons is, if we look back, when you go back pretty far, really far, you have to assume the exact same amount of carbon 14 activity existed hundreds of thousands of years ago. We don't know. We really don't know. Right? And will exist in the future. We don't. But it's a decent way to get an approximate age of things. So if we dig up a relic in the desert, if it's organic, it has to be organic. It has to have carbon in it. And if I dig up something like a porcelain dish, I can't tell how old it is from carbon dating. It doesn't have any organic material in it. It has to be something that was alive at one time. All right. So anyway, let's get back to this. I'm still not done. That's how many half-lives it underwent. How long is a half-life? 5,730 years. So what do you think I'm going to do with that? I'm going to multiply it, right? Oopsie. Hit twice. I'm going to multiply it. Multiply that by the half-life, and the actual age of that piece of wood is going to be about 3,750 years. There's another reason it's not incredibly accurate. I mean, perfectly accurate. There is a lot of debate over it. I mean, you're talking about the amounts you're talking about for carbon-14 are extremely small. So when you're working at that level, it's hard to be 100%. If I get that number, does that mean it's exactly 3,750 years? No. But it's going to be around there somewhere, because the decay rates, you know, are not going to be perfect, nor are your measurements at that small of a level going to be perfect. Very small error. Any very small changes introduce fairly large error when you're dealing with small amounts. Because remember, I told you, the amount of carbon-14 in your body that's radioactive is 0.0-something%, 0.00-something%. It's very, very small. Okay, so there you go. Those are the first two ways you can do it. You can find how long, or you can find how much would be left over. I got one more to do. Okay. Look at that guy. This one, I want to determine how radioactive will it be. Okay. And by the way, these kind of things are actually, these calculations I'm talking about are, again, I try to every time show you at least tell you a little bit something about practical applications of this. If you work in a hospital, if you work in nuclear medicine, they have to inject or sometimes implant certain radioactive isotopes into a human body, different places. And they need to determine how long they're going to be, those people who are walking around with these radioactive dyes or whatever, are going to be radioactive. Like, for example, they may have to tell them not to sleep in the same bed as their spouse for the next week because they're going to be radioactive. And they shouldn't be doing that. They shouldn't be holding their grandchildren and be around pregnant women because they're going to be radioactive. They may be being treated for cancer. They may be getting a dye for a CAT scan or something like that some other test. And so you're injecting this nuclear stuff into them. It's radioactive. They need to calculate and tell that person, depending on the dose they had, how long they have to wait before they can, you know, be around other people. Okay, and this would be a kind of an example of that. We want to find out how radioactive will you be after 2 hours of a guy who has a half-life of 40 minutes. Okay, let's see if we can do this one. All right, again, we want to figure out how many half-lives we have. And the half-lives it's going to have undergone. I made it a relatively easy number to figure out. Remember, 2 hours is 120 minutes. So how many half-lives is this guy undergo? Three. Made the numbers relatively easy here. If I know he underwent three half-lives, that's X, right? That's what X is. I can set up my equation and solve for the activity, right? 1 half to the x power equals a over a sub 0. So it's 1 half to the third power. My original activity was 4.81 curies. What's my new activity going to be? What's going to be left over? 0.125. equals A over 4.81. Basically, it's going to be that. 0.601 curies. And at certain points, they'll have a chart, they'll have a, where you're considered safe again. After another goes so many half-lives, and by the way, this is the truth, this is the case for all most things. If something undergoes a certain number of half-lives, it's considered to be, you know, it pretty much is gone. All right, it's not completely gone. Remember, it's going to take a very long time to get rid of the last of those things because you saw how that graph goes like this. But if it undergoes 5, 6, 7, 8 half-lives and you start cutting those things in half and half and half and half, there's not going to be much of it left after a certain number. I forget there is an exact number, but it's not important you memorize that. All right. Good enough. So these are the kind of questions you're going to get in these problems right here. Copy those down. I think in this your class is page 564. Let me double check that. Yeah. So those are the problems you got to do. Do yourself a favor. Let me stop the thing here. We only have a single today, so work on it now for whenever you get done, but you don't have to finish it before.